Hello everyone and welcome to the chemistry class, to the section of thermodynamics. I hope you people are doing well, studying sincerely and attending your tests. Anyways, for today we are going to start up with the next concept in the thermodynamics and what is known as entropy. Now basically when we speak as an entropy, you just go on imagining things now. When we say about the entropy, entropy is nothing more than the randomness or the disorder in a system. Now, for example, try to visualize the atoms which are very well organized when we see a solid substance. Or if I take into consideration of a Lattice system as what we had seen yesterday. So, in this Lattice system, what do you see is those particular ions what we have. Those ions are perfectly organized, correct? So here the entropy is less. If this particular lattice, as what we have, if this lattice is going to be broken down into number of pieces where all the ions are scattered. So when they are scattered, what will happen is the entropy increases because of the disorderness is going to increase. So basically when we speak about the entropy, entropy is nothing more than the disorder of a system. Okay, so whenever we speak about the entropy, what you have to visualize is the system, whether it is a solid, whether it's a liquid, or whether it's a gaseous phase of a system, is completely disordered, completely randomized. Okay, so we can also say as it is a measurement, it is actually a measurement, it's actually a measurement of randomness of a system. Okay, so it is basically as how much disordered is that particular system that we have taken into consideration. More it is disordered, more is the entropy. Less it is disorder, less is the entropy. Simply as it is. Okay, now this particular entropy, we represent it by the term as S. Now the question that arises is, fine, the entropy is like a disorderness or a randomness of a system, but how is it going to help us? Okay, so it all links up with the reactions. Reaction of chemicals. So naturally, when we speak about the reactions, what we are going to have? We have the reactants. Reactants usually get converted into their products. Correct. So when we look at a reactant from its orderness, from how well these particular atoms are being arranged, or how better is it scattered. So it all goes with the reactants and products. So whenever we see a reaction, what we understand is there are arrangements. There is a continuous rearrangement of the atoms or ions that is occurring between the reactants and the products. Okay, so whenever we take a look into a reaction, there is a continuous rearrangement of bonds, you can say. Okay, of course the bonds are going to get connected to the atoms. So therefore, there is a continuous rearrangement of these particular bonds which are connected to the atoms. And therefore, what happens is, in a reactant, there is a particular arrangement, or I can say as, there is a particular pattern of arrangement of the atoms, or you have the ions, okay, or the particular molecules, okay. But when a reaction starts and it proceeds converting a reactant to a product, this particular product is going to have a different type of pattern. The arrangement of the atoms, the arrangement of the ions will change, Okay, so here the another type, the another type of pattern or pattern of these atoms, or I would say as the ions, are going to occur. Okay, so now we are going to compare which among these two is going to be more disordered. Suppose, for an example, let's say when the reaction is occurring, as the reactants get converted into the product, in case if this particular product pattern what we are getting during the reaction, if this particular pattern is more, if it is more disordered, okay, so what is happening? The reaction is occurring in such a way that the reactants are getting converted into product, and if in the case if products are more disordered, that means this pattern is distorted a lot. In such condition, we would say that the reaction is proceeding. It is proceeding with increase in entropy. Okay, this is how you need to visualize it. So there is a reaction, and when the reaction is occurring, and when the reaction completes, what is the status of this product? Whether in this particular product, are these atoms very well organized or not? If it is not so organized, if everything, every single atoms have been disrupted in a lot, many manner with respect to its bond. So if it is more disordered, then we would say that this particular reaction has occurred with increase in entropy. Alright. On the other hand, if I would see that a reaction is occurring in such a way that the reactants are giving rise to products, but the reactant pattern what we have is more distorted, or you would say as it is more disordered when we compare to that of the product. In such conditions, we would say that the reaction is proceeding. The reaction is proceeding with decrease in entropy. Okay, so this is how the entire concept of the entropy is defined. Okay, now the question that arises is, how do we calculate the entropy? What is the formula for? So for a given reaction, we calculate the entropy as delta S, change in entropy, is equal to summation of entropies of product minus summation of the entropies of the reactants. Now, whether you can use this, or you can also go with respect to the change in entropy is equal to S2 minus S1. Now, quite simple, as S2 is nothing more than the entropy of a product minus the entropy of a reactant. Correct. Now, there are several cases that we are going to study in order to understand this entire concept of the entropy in a better manner. Now, okay, let us understand this entire process of the entropy taking some cases or examples. For a moment, let me say that I have a substance. Okay, now when I am saying a substance, it can either be in terms of the solids, it can be either in the terms of liquids, or either it can be in the terms of the gases. Right? Now, you need to understand about this disorderness or the randomness with respect to the atoms, the arrangement of the atoms, or the arrangement of the molecules, or the arrangement of the ions. If you see, in case, if it is a salt, it's perfectly organized, all the ions are perfectly organized in order to give a lattice. Correct? That goes same with respect to any of the solids. So basically speaking, any of the solids that we take into consideration here, all these particular atoms, ions, or the molecules are very well organized. So here there is a perfect organization. As it is perfectly organized, okay, as it is perfectly organized,
a randomness. So it is less disordered.
So as it is less disordered, so what is going to happen? It is going to have the least entropy. Okay, so solids are going to have the least entropy, less entropy.
As we go from the solids to the liquids, what is going to happen with respect to the atoms or the molecules? They are going to be scattered. They are a little bit free when we compare to that of the solids. So naturally, the disorderness increases a bit. And when we look at the gases, here we will see that whether it's ions or whether it's atoms or molecules, all of these are scattered. As these particular molecules are scattered, or the atoms, ions are scattered, they are highly disordered. Right? As they are highly disordered, we can say one thing, that it has a direct influence with respect to its entropy. So therefore, this particular case is going to have the highest entropy. Okay, so basically, if we speak with respect to its magnitude, we would say that it is going to be as, the highest is going to be for the solids. So we would say that the least is going to be for the solids because of their arrangements. Further, a bit higher would be in the terms of the liquids, because these particular atoms or molecules are a little bit free. Finally, what we have is the gases. In the gases, as the atoms or the ions or molecules which are involved are freely scattered. So therefore, what is going to happen? Disorderness increases, therefore the entropy increases. So if we write it down, we would have the entire magnitude as magnitude of the entropy, that is, in the solids, it is going to be the least, followed by, it is going to be a bit greater in the liquids, and the highest is going to be in the gaseous state of any substance that we take into consideration. So this is our first example. Let us go with respect to the second one. So in order to explain the second one, first let us take into consideration of certain elements. For example, helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, and radon. Let us say that these are the inert gases as we have. So, can I say that in this particular case, all these elements are belonging to the same family? So, whenever we try to compare the entropy between the elements of the same family, remember one rule, that higher the mass, higher is the entropy. Okay, so the rule is higher the mass, higher is the entropy. Okay, so if we have this particular condition, we would say that naturally, entropy for helium would be less compared to entropy of neon. Entropy of neon would be less compared to entropy of argon, which would be less compared to entropy of krypton, which would be less than compared to the entropy of xenon, lastly, compared to that of the entropy of radon. Correct. Now, it also goes true when we take a look into the halogens. So if we take into consideration of the halogens, okay, that is the halogen family. So in case of the halogens, again, entropy of fluorine would be less compared to that of entropy of chlorine, followed by entropy of bromine, finally, entropy of iodine would be the greatest. Correct. So this is how the entropy is going to increase. Now, this was the second example. Let us go into the third example. Now, before explaining the third example, let us take into consideration let us take into consideration of the three molecules. In the first case, I would like to take into consideration of ethyl molecule. Okay, second consideration, let's take it into consideration with respect to ethene. And the third one, let me take into consideration of ethane. Okay, so we have the three over here, ethyne, ethene and ethane. So what we see over here is that as we are traveling from the left to the right, I would see that the number of atoms are increasing. As the number of atoms are increasing, the bond between the two different types of atoms in a polyatomic molecule is increasing. So greater the number of the atoms in a molecule, greater it has the bonds, greater it is going to have the capacity of absorbing the thermal energy. So as the number of atoms are going to increase, in this case as the number of atoms increases, so it has a direct influence on the thermal energy. That is, the thermal energy is going to increase. Okay, so as a result, here what is going to happen? The thermal energy, that is the capacity to absorb the energy, also increases. So therefore, the thermal energy is going to increase. Okay, as the thermal energy is going to increase, what is going to happen? The disorderness is going to increase. Okay, so it has a direct influence on the disorderness of the system. So therefore, we would say that in this entire scenario, the highest disorderness is in the ethane because of the greater number of atoms in this scenario. While next would be ethene and the least would be ethyne. So therefore, right, the entropy of ethyne is going to be less when we compare to the entropy of ethene, which is going to be less when we compare to that of the entropy of ethane. Right? So this is how we would like to conclude. Now there is one more example that refers with the state of a system, which we will take a look just after this point. So, the fourth point of the discussion, and the fourth point of the discussion goes with respect to the processes. Okay, now we have already studied about the different types of processes. For example, first one what we had studied was about the fusion. Next one what we had studied about was the vaporization. Third one was the sublimation, correct? So here, such kind of processes, let me note it down. The first type of process, for example, if the process is of fusion, or if the process is of vaporization, such kind of processes directly influence the entropy. That is, such kind of processes tend to increase the entropy during the process. Now, please check it down. Fusion. Fusion in the sense that you are converting a solid substance into its liquid form. Correct. The molecules will begin to move much more freely when we compare to that of the solid states. So, therefore, it is going to increase the entropy. Next one, vaporization. From the liquid states to the vapors. Again, what is going to happen? These molecules will be much more free when we compare to that of the liquid states. So therefore, what is happening here is the disorderness increases and therefore the entropy is going to increase. So the process such as the fusion process or the process of vaporization is going to directly influence the entropy by increasing it. Okay, so now when we consider the process such as crystallization. So this particular crystallization process is a process wherein you are trying to
You are trying to bring back something from a liquid state into the solid state. So what is going to happen? All the atoms or the molecules which are involved are going to be perfectly organized. As they start getting perfectly organized, entropy decreases. So for such kind of processes, these process of crystallization tend to decrease the entropy of the system. Okay, so this is how it all goes. Now let us start with the next concept. The next concept we need to study is the entropy change. The entropy change in an reversible process. Okay. So please try to note over here, we are speaking with respect to a reversible process. So now let's take into consideration of a particular system. And let us say that this system is going to work in an isothermal condition. So my first condition is it is an isothermal condition. So in this condition, what is going to happen is we are going to supply Q amount of heat to this system. Okay, so as we supply Q amount of heat to this particular system here, let me say that the entropy change that occurs in the system. Okay, so for this system, the entropy change for system is going to be equal to, you are supplying in the heat. Okay, let me write it down as Q. Okay, so Q of a system, for the system we are supplying, at what condition it is? It is going to be for a reversible process. So let me write it as REV. Okay, now it's an isothermal condition. Let me say that the temperature around this is going to be, the temperature that we are going to set is going to be, let us say that it is T. So now divide this part T. So this will give me the entropy change that occurs in a system over here. Now you are supplying in the energy, so therefore let us give over here as Q. Now the amount of heat transferred from the surroundings to the system. Okay, because this particular system is absorbing that amount of energy. Let's say it is absorbing from the surrounding itself. So that time the surrounding is losing that amount of heat to this system. Correct. So the loss of entropy in a surrounding. Okay, so in the surroundings it is going to be as Q amount of heat is being absorbed from the surroundings to the system. So when it is happening that, let's give it as Q is for the surroundings into what we have over here divided by, sorry, it's divided by T, that is the temperature of the system. Okay. But at this particular point, Q amount of heat is lost by the surrounding. It is losing to the system. So when it is losing to the system, we will give it as a negative sign only. Okay. So now it's a final term that we need to see, that is the total change in the entropy is going to be given as equal to the change in the entropy of a system plus the change in the entropy of the surroundings. Correct. And this is equal to, that is delta S of total change in the entropy is equal to Q divided by T, that is for the system, minus of Q divided by T, that is from the surroundings. Correct. Now, that is nothing more than delta S total is equal to zero. Now, what does this mean is, first thing that we need to recognize is the entire work that has been done in an isothermal condition. So, at the isothermal condition, there cannot be work done. Okay. As a result of which, at the isothermal condition, No heat is going to be supplied out, neither no heat is going to be absorbed in. This particular process does not occur in an isothermal process. As a result of which, you need to understand from this particular sequence, that is Q is equal to 0. So for any isothermal process, the amount of the heat, or I would rather say it as the change in heat itself, is going to be equal to 0. Such kind of processes we call it as an adiabatic processes. The process which occur without any change in the heat. Okay, so this is a condition for the entropy change in a reversible process. Let us proceed with the final concept for this particular video, and that is going to be the entropy change in an irreversible process. So the process is irreversible. Let us keep that in mind, and let us consider that we have a system. Let's say that this particular system, as what we are taking into consideration, is going to have a temperature. Let's say this particular system has a temperature of T1, and the surrounding, as what we have here, the surrounding is at the temperature of T2. Alright, so when we have this particular considerations, let us say the T1, what we have, is at a higher temperature, that is the temperature of the system is quite very high. So condition is T1 is greater than T2, right? So let's keep this in mind. Now, if T1 is greater than T2, then possibly the heat is going to flow from the system to the surroundings. That is, the system starts liberating heat energy. So as a result of which, second point is the heat flows from the system to surroundings. Right? Now, let us have this quite correctly. Now I ask you, that is, the heat is flowing from the system to the surroundings, the heat energy of the system is going to decrease. As a result of which, its entropy also decreases. So therefore, can we write down this as delta S for the system? We can give it as equal to minus of Q over T. This is our first point of consideration. Okay, now let us go with the second point, that is, as the heat is being evolved, as the heat is being given out by the system, this heat goes to the surrounding. That means the heat of the surrounding is going to increase. Naturally, the entropy of the system, naturally the entropy of the surroundings increases. As a result of which, let us give it as delta S of the surroundings is going to be equal to plus Q over T. Now, what consideration that we have taken over here? For a system, it is T1 as temperature, and for the surrounding, it is going to be the T2 as the temperature. Correct. Now, as we have done in the previous concept, let us take delta S, that is the total entropy change, is equal to delta S of a system plus delta S of the surroundings. Now, when we have this, delta S total is going to be equal to system. How much do we have over here? Minus of Q2 over here plus Q over T2 over here. Let's reorganize this. So we will write it down as total entropy change is going to be equal to Q over T2 minus Q over T1. Okay, so if I have this particular thing properly, then I will take Q as a common one. So this is going to become as T1 minus T2 over T1 into T2. But what do we know? What was the first consideration that we have taken here? T1 is quite greater than T2. Naturally, if that is a thing done, then I would say that this particular sequence would end up giving me, this entire sequence would end up giving me delta S total is going to be greater than 0, because T1 is going to be greater than T2. So naturally, the entropy change in a irreversible process is going to be greater than zero. Okay, this is what it concludes now. So the entropy change for any irreversible process is going to be greater than zero. So the final concept that we need to discuss now is going to be as the entropy change. Okay, the entropy change in phase transformation. Okay, so now when we take a look into the phase transformation, first point that we need to discuss now is what is this phase transformation. Now, quite naturally, it is very, very easy whenever we have a matter, okay, and if this particular matter is going to change its state, okay, what I am saying over here is going to change its state. That means it is changing from its solid state into liquid, let's say. So here, it is considered as a phase transformation or the change in the phase, okay. So now, whenever it changes its state, we consider it as a phase transformation. Okay, so now, if it is a phase transformation over here, we need to understand that how it is going to influence the change in the entropy. Okay, so let us take a first process into consideration, and that is going to be the melting process. Okay, so if it is a melting process, let me take it over here as delta S of melting. So this is equal to, okay, so now from where are we changing? We are changing it from a solid state to the liquid state, right? So therefore, let's take over here entropy. S refers to entropy, entropy of the liquid minus entropy of the solid. Okay, now this particular process is nothing more than a process of fusion. So therefore, let us give this as delta H of fusion, enthalpy change of a fusion, right? So divided by temperature, that is of melting. So Tm refers to the melting temperature. S refers to the entropies. So this is for my first process, and that is going to be for the melting process. Let us discuss about the next process. The process wherein we are going to change the state from the liquid to the vapors. So when we change that, so second point, delta S of vaporization. Okay, so for the vaporization, entropy of that particular substance in the gaseous state minus the entropy of that particular substance in the liquid state. Okay, so when we have this consideration, we can write it down as a delta H of vaporization, the whole thing divided by TB. TB refers to the boiling temperature. So boiling temperature, and what we have delta H of vaporization, that is nothing more than the change in enthalpy at the process of vaporization. Okay, so let's go with the last one. So the last one as what we have is the sublimation process. So delta S in a sublimation process is going to be equal to delta S of the gaseous state minus S of its solid state, that is entropy of solid state, that is equal to delta H of sublimation divided by P sublimation, that is the temperature of sublimation. Okay, so this is how we will conclude the entire entropy section. So, we'll meet you in the next video. Do take care.